Well, I have a video for you today that has been a long time coming. It's actually been requested several times, and I'm a little excited to be able to do it finally. And that is, what are the pros and the cons of living DNA? Howdy, I'm Andy Lee with Family History Fanatics, where we help you understand your DNA, climb your family tree, and write your ancestor stories along the way. Now, Living DNA came out in 2016, and I think I did a DNA test with them in 2017. And for the longest time, people have been asking me to do a review of Living DNA, and I held off because there were some features on it that were really needed for genetic genealogy that I wanted them to have released before I did my review of it. Well, they've released those features, and so now they're ready for my review. Please bear in mind that this may change over the years as they add and improve features, so make sure you come back to this channel frequently and take a look for any updated videos. First, let's talk about the pros of Living DNA. What are the things that I really like about Living DNA? The first thing that I really like is they give you very accurate haplogroup identification. Now, if you've tested with 23andMe, they also give you haplogroup identification. And if you've tested with Family Tree DNA, you have to have used either one of their Y-DNA tests or their mitochondrial DNA tests in order to get that haplogroup determination. With Living DNA, if you pay for their autosomal test, you get that haplogroup determination, and it is very accurate, mainly because they're testing a lot more SNPs. So for instance, with the paternal haplogroup, they test 22,000 SNPs on the Y chromosome. With the maternal haplogroup, I believe it's around 2,500 SNPs on the mitochondrial DNA. And so these haplogroups are very specific as far as where you lie. And that is one of the great things that I like about Living DNA. Because of this, there's actually 50% more SNPs on the mitochondrial DNA that are tested than 23andMe, and there's 7 times as many SNPs on the Y-DNA that's tested. So when I say it's a more accurate haplogroup, basically if you've tested with 23andMe and you've tested with Living DNA, I would trust the Living DNA as the most accurate haplogroup. The only way you're going to get a more accurate haplogroup is if you do the full mitochondrial DNA test from Family Tree DNA, or if you do something like the Big Y test at Family Tree DNA. And both of those are going to be much more expensive than just the autosomal test at Living DNA. So the very first thing that I like is their accurate haplogroups, because they test a lot of SNPs on both the Y chromosome and on the mitochondrial DNA. The second thing that I like about Living DNA is their detailed Great Britain admixture. Now, I've told you before, with admixture or ethnicity or heritage, depending on which company and how they describe it, it is accurate at the continental level, and there's a few subpopulations below a continental level that are also fairly accurate. However, once it gets down to the country or even smaller levels, it's not so much accurate as, you know, everybody would like or everybody even thinks. With Living DNA, they have advertised that their focus is on Great Britain. And for their reference population, they've actually used some previous DNA studies from Great Britain. Now, what this has allowed them to do is it's allowed them to break up this Great Britain DNA into much smaller population groups. Now, I'm not going to say that all these are accurate necessarily, but it's really interesting to actually see that. One of the things I did want to see first off, though, is I have a significant portion of ancestry from Cornwall, England. Now, Cornwall is the tiny corner of England, and it's a little isolated from the rest of England, and it's actually one of the last places that got any admixture from the Romans, from the Anglos and Saxons, so it's stayed its Celtic self for many, many centuries. Well, my great-grandfather was from Cornwall, and his ancestry is all in Cornwall for hundreds of years before that. So I expected to see a significant percentage of my DNA from Cornwall. And it turns out that 23andMe actually reported that I have 27% of my DNA from Cornwall, which is more than the, you know, about 12.5% that I would expect. But That's for what I think as far as where the ethnicity and admixture estimates are. I think it's still very reasonable. You can also see that there's about a dozen different areas here in Great Britain that my DNA is linked to. And so this is a breakdown that's really much more specific than you're going to get from other companies. Now, how accurate this is, I'm not going to say that this is greatly accurate, although with my Cornwall, I can see that, yes, they do identify that a significant portion of my ancestry is from Cornwall. So the third thing that I really like with Living DNA is that they have a partnership with Find My Past. And for those of you who don't know, Find My Past is a British company that is similar to Ancestry or MyHeritage. They provide records, they allow you to build a tree and link those records and connect with other people on their website. Now, why I like partnerships like this is because one company usually can't do everything great. So for instance, Living DNA, they're focused on genetics and genealogy and providing those DNA tests that support the genetic genealogy. Whereas Find My Past is focused on records and building family trees. Both of them in particular are focused on the United Kingdom. That doesn't mean that they only have records or they only have DNA tests from the United Kingdom. They have them from people throughout the world and they have records throughout the world. But that's what their focus is. So if you are from the United Kingdom or you have a significant amount of your heritage from the United Kingdom, then I'd recommend that you take a look at both Living DNA and Find My Past. Now, not everything is going to be smelling great all the time. And I'll admit, Living DNA has some cons that I'd like to point out as well. Coincidentally, the very first one happens to relate it to the last pro. And that is, I can't find a way that I can link my Living DNA results to my Find My Past account. This is very frustrating. I've tried to go in there a couple of times and see, well, there should be a button where I can link these two accounts, because with every other company, when I've used them, that they have links like this, there's usually a partnership link where you go in and you click on the button, you put in your login information, and it merges those two accounts together so that you have that information available. That's what I was hoping to see on either Find My Past or Living DNA. Unfortunately, I don't. Every time I go to the DNA link or the, you know, upload my results or that, it brings me to this sign up page where I can buy another kit. Now, I did my Living DNA test before they had their partnership with Find My Past. So it might be that those results can't be linked, but if I do another test, then it will be linked. I just haven't had the desire or the money to pay for another test from Living DNA in order to link that to Find My Past. So if anybody out there actually has their DNA results linked to Find My Past, I'd be curious if it was because you took a test after they had this partnership, or if you've been able to link your past results to Find My Past. And at some point, I'm actually going to contact one of these companies' customer service to find out if there is a way. But right now, it's certainly not intuitive to the average user to go in and figure out how to link those accounts. The next con that I have to say is, while Living DNA has been working on their cousin matching and they've got that developed and released now to the public, you're going to have very few matches compared to all of the other genetic genealogy companies. Now, when I say very few matches, I've got one match. That's it. Not one good match, one match. I was feeling bad about that. But then I went and looked at my wife's account. She has no matches. We've been open as far as sharing. So, you know, I've checked to make sure that all of the buttons are clicked and the options for opting into matching are there. And they have been. They've been this way for months. And one match, zero matches. So it's not like you just have a couple of hundred matches. You may log in and you may see that, hey, we have no matches or we have very few matches. Now, it's very difficult to do any kind of genealogy through DNA if you don't have matches. DNA with one person by itself is not very valuable. I need other people that match me in order to do genetic genealogy. Now, this may be a result of the Living DNA database is very small. It may be that their matching algorithms just are not the same level that other companies' matching algorithms are. But in any case, while this is a tool that genetic genealogists are going to need, it's not very helpful for me. And I've got a lot of British ancestry as well as my wife, so I would expect more matches. Hopefully, this is something that's going to be changing in the future. But as of right now, it's not very helpful for me, so it's going to be on the con list. Next is missing admixture populations. So this is interesting because I have, you know, the admixture at the beginning, which is great for Great Britain because that's where the focus is. And then on the cons, we have one now where they're missing populations. Admixture or ethnicity or heritage results are funny because it's probably what most people buy a DNA kit in order to get. And yet it is the least scientific, the least accurate of the information that you're actually given from those DNA test results. Well, I don't really have a complaint about mine, but again, most of my ancestry is actually from Great Britain. So that's what Living DNA said. That's what all the other companies say as well. I didn't find anything unusual about that. Now with my wife, she has a significant portion of her DNA that is from Germany. Now she still has a lot that is from England, and you can see that it has lots of this English DNA highlighted. It has some there up in Scandinavia, some down in the Iberian Peninsula. But the one thing that's missing is there is no German DNA that has been found. They've not identified any DNA as being from this German region. Now there's obviously lots of migrations going around and mixture of this DNA. It's really difficult to actually separate out, you know, where certain DNA is from. But with my wife, with as much German heritage as she has, I would have expected at least, you know, a percent or two. It really should, you know, be higher than that, but they got nothing. Now, my wife at one of the conferences, she went and talked with Living DNA representatives about this. And they said that, yeah, we're still working on our ethnicity results as far as this. We've noticed this with some people where certain populations that are known, and we're not talking about trace populations, like, oh, I have one Native American ancestor seven generations back and it's not showing up on DNA. No, this is talking about, hey, I got a grandparent that's from Germany or something like that, where we're talking 10, 15, 20, sometimes as much as 50% of your DNA should probably be from some area. Other companies all identify it as that from that area. Maybe not the exact same percentage, but every other DNA company identifies some of my wife's DNA as being from Germany. Living DNA doesn't. And the Living DNA representative said that they're still working on that and you can expect improvements. And that's what you can expect with all of your admixture results. They are not going to be static. They're going to keep on changing. So this is also another con that I hope that Living DNA can fix over the next while and start to show a better accuracy of where people might be from. So those are my three pros and my three cons about Living DNA. If you want to learn about ancestry or about my heritage, you can look at those videos right here on this screen. And if you have any questions or comments about Living DNA, put it in the comments below. And make sure you subscribe to the channel and click on the bell so you can be notified about upcoming episodes.